Hello, you wonderful people, and welcome to another episode of Untitled Reviews. This being a show where I talk about dramas that I watch. For today's episode, I'm going to talk about Beef, Season 1, Episode 8. Great episode. A lot of really interesting things went down in this episode, so let's break it down. Well, first and foremost, I love the juxtaposition, which, if you know anything, that's my favorite word. That's my number one go-to word because I just love it so much. But the juxtaposition between Amy and Danny's story. I almost was wondering, like, are we going to get all of Amy's story this episode? It's like, no. And I thought it was, like, beautiful. Halfway through the episode, we do the inverse, where we rewind from where Amy is today, sprinkle in some of today, but we're rewinding backwards in her life and choices. And then, like, when we get to, like, a little bit after she was born, we start off with, like, sometime after Danny was born, and then, like, go through, like, him getting older and older, and how the choices they made, like, where it kind of started, and how it manifested into something, where it's just, like, once again, it all starts with somewhere. This is the point I've been making in the previous episodes, is it took little things that were happening that they never quite dealt with. They never dealt with the core of the issues and everything else over the course of their, as we see, it wasn't just everything over the course of this series, but everything in their lives now and in the past has always been a symptom of this core thing that happened. It's a trauma that's inside of them. First and foremost, we start off with Amy back in 2008, and it was like a random hookup situation. I was like, hey, yo. And I don't know if that's supposed to read, is that supposed to be, I mean, now I think you have to look back on the Paul situation. Like, once again, I could be, but the fact that she used those exact same words, I mean, everyone's got their kink, so maybe it stayed, it's always just been her thing, but she told the dude to spit on it, just like she told Paul to. So I'm like, that's interesting. That's meant to be a direct correlation there, you know? So, and then it's just like, when she was looking in the mirror, she saw something else staring back. I was like, is that how you see yourself or something? And then, you know, present day, Amy's talking to Fumi, and Fumi's like, yes, you screwed up, but I don't like the way George handled this, just grabbing June and going to the hotel. And even Amy's like, why are you helping me, Fumi? You don't even, she's like, well, I'm a helpful person. It's like, but you don't have to. Like, if me and George get divorced, you get half of my stuff anyway, and that way you don't have to, like, go on these shopping sprees with me. But for Fumi, it's like, she sees what's there, because she's like, you say that he's your anchor, that he's so important to you, but if it wasn't for you, my son wouldn't be the artist that he is. Like, he's no artist. He'd be the one drowning in the middle of an ocean if it wasn't for you. So it isn't just a thing of, Amy thinks, like, oh, I'm all bad and George is all the good, and I'm like, he's the only thing salvageable between us. She thinks, like, it's all, like, I'm too messed up and I'm too broken. And that's, we really delved into that last episode. And so, in the case of Fumi's trying to tell her, like, no, that's not the case. He needs you kind of like you need him type of situation. But I don't know if she looked at that as a positive. Like, she's like, maybe the only reason why I have some artistic value to him and I help in that regard is because I am so jacked up. So it made her, well, looking back, we found out, like, when she was a senior in high school, this was like, what, 2001, she ended up finding out that her dad was having an affair. You know, and then she saw that thing again, which, you know, jumping ahead a little bit, well, jumping backwards, in fact, we find out what it is. It's something she saw in a book. It's meant to be a manifestation of this is, I don't know whether it's like some kind of like creature from mythology or something like that, but Amy, it's a manifestation of Amy's guilt, and she created it from a very young age. We'll dive into that more when we get to there, but obviously she went to go visit her parents, and it was almost a thing of she needed to talk to her parents about it, because she was like, all right, does mom, she thought maybe her mom didn't know about her dad's affair, and it's like, she kind of, and is that also, I think it's a little bit of that, once again, that Asian situation of like, I mean, I think this could be applicable to any, like, group, but I feel like it's probably really prevalent in like an Asian culture situation where it's like, oh, we've been talking to other people bought their parents houses, bought, you know, it's like, oh, you could have bought us a new house or whatever and with the money, but Amy's like, but I paid off your mortgage. It's like, yeah, but you could have gotten us a new house and one close to you, because that's what these other kids are doing to their parents. Because that, I mean, that's always meant to be, because especially in the Asian culture, like out of any culture, it's always respect your elders. But like that goes even further and beyond in the Asian culture, where it's like, in any Asian culture, like your parents are, you're supposed to like, I think you're supposed to kind of keep them close, or like you're always meant to be in a situation because it's like, right. And especially in Amy's case, it's like her dad throwing it back in her face. Because for her, it's like, oh, why would I let June be around you when I turn out the way I did? And they, like, oh, here you go again, blaming us. Like, we're the reason why you're, you know, it's like, all we did this and we sacrificed for you. And what do we get for it? You being ungrateful. And it's just like, and especially, once again, this is, I don't know, once again, I can't fully comment on it because I'm not Asian. So I, you know, but I've heard people talk about this and I don't think it's just an Asian thing. I think it's applicable in the Black community as well, where it's like, I don't think we always talk about our feelings. And for Amy, she kind of feels that with her parents, where it's like, yo, you, like, you never, like, really wanted to talk about anything. We just kind of bottle stuff up. And she had actually talked about that earlier. She had talked about that earlier in the series when it came to, like, therapy and stuff. She had opened up about her parents and stuff. Because it turns out her mom did know about the affairs. But it's like, we just don't talk about it. So you and me are not about to talk about it. But Amy was hoping that if she could talk to her mom about things, it's like, oh, are you and George having troubles? But it's almost, and but then what does Amy do? She goes, no, I'm not talking about me and George. I'm talking about you and Dad. Did the exact same thing, the inverse of that last episode, when the therapist was like, oh, so what's this about your mom and dad? Like, was there love conditioner? She's like, I wasn't talking about them. I was talking about George and Mia. Like, rather than focusing on the thing that should be focused on, they're kind of deflecting. Because, once again, her situation with George is kind of a symptom of everything else. Because as we rewind back further, because she had thrown it in her dad's face. It's like, you guys never wanted me in the first place. It was a thing of you happened and they just kind of accepted it and rolled with it. It's a thing of, oh, children are expensive, and oh, you were spending money. He's like, $50. He's like, oh, you see this, and this? That was my money. So it's like, they were unhappy, but they stayed together. Now, are they happy now? I have no idea. Maybe they were able to work through all their BS, and maybe they're in a good place. But when you look, it feels like it's not a good thing at all. The fact is, you know, in comparison to something else I've been watching recently, where there was a cheating situation involved, they fought and they worked through it. It's still kind of an issue, but it's like something they fought and worked through. Like, hey, we're going to work through this. Whereas this family, it's just kind of like, we don't talk about it. Whatever we're dealing with, we kind of bury it down and we don't talk about it. We see, that's kind of like Danny's issue as well. But once again, going back, like, she was a child. She was like 4 years old or something when she heard her parents arguing like that. And she saw this picture in a book and it's like, right, this thing comes after you. It always knows when you're watching. And for Amy, anytime she's done something bad, she always sees this thing because it's a representation of, I can't tell anyone your secrets, Amy, because if I ever told them your secrets, no one would love you. That is a fucked up mentality for a child to have, and Amy's carried that. That's why she bottles everything up. That's why she keeps everything so close to the chest, is because she knows, she's like, she feels like if she says anything, she tells the truth, everything's going to come crumbling down because no one's going to love her anymore. And you're just like, Jesus, you're like, that's so heartbreaking that she's got that type of mentality, that she's afraid like that, you know? So for one, you understand where her issues with her parents come from, because it's like, there's just so much there that they don't talk about. My parents have an effed up relationship. It feels like, do they really, really love each other? Because that's why she's like, oh, you guys are going on a trip around Europe together. Because she kind of hasn't really kept in touch with her parents for the past couple of years. They were like, yeah, when's the last time we like saw each other or talked to each other? It was like 2 years ago or something. Because she wanted to keep herself as far away from her family, because that was her way of dealing with everything, and also keeping June as far away. And she ultimately ends up talking to George because Fumi sets up them talking, and she, her mom, Fumi was saying like, right, it say like it was just a message, you were messing with the kid, nothing actually happened. But for Amy, it's like, I don't want to lie anymore. I don't want to hide anything. So here it goes. I'm going to tell you not only about Paul, that we really did sleep together, but also about Danny. And it's like, wait, you let me become friends with this guy? You knew who he really was? Wait, this all started, you slept with this guy because of your road rage? And she's like, yeah, that kind of, truth be told, it is, when you like really like simplify, that is what this kind of came down to. Like, it was my road rage led to me sleeping with this guy. So, and it's like, why are you obsessed with him? And even Amy's like, I don't even think it's about Danny. It's about me. And Because George was like, yeah, I thought it was simply an affair, I felt so much better. But realizing so much more spiraled out from this, it's like, are you crazy, Amy? Do you know what could have happened? You put our family in danger. You put June in danger. Like, this whole thing between you and Danny is so psychotic. And she recognizes that. And because for her, it's like, I'm a bad person. And that was, like, hard to hear. It's like, Jesus, I think you have a lot of issues, but, you know, I don't know. I mean, over the course of this series, you'd probably be like, no, she is a bad person. There's a lot of psychological, I mean, it doesn't change, like, she's done some bad things, but you can turn things around. Like, I don't think all her stuff in her past, like, makes her a bad person. Like, oh, stealing, like, her, like, stealing and skipping school as a teenager, or, like, you know, random hookups. I mean, once again, I think it's a byproduct of something else. But also, like, I'm not going to say, like, oh, that makes you a bad person because you were, like, having some random hookups or whatever like that. Because, once again, it's just, like, it was all a byproduct of, like, because it makes it sadder, because it's like, because now it also makes that, once again, that what was the Paul thing? You're feeling a void inside of yourself, like something inside of you, you're trying to feel it. And same thing was kind of happening there over and over again, you know? And it's just like, and once again, that, I mean, we haven't seen it present day, but I guess maybe it's a thing of maybe she has been seeing it and we just haven't seen that view of things for her. But yeah, George wants a divorce now. And she's like, fine, you can take everything. You can have everything. You can have the house. Just don't take Junie away from me. And he's like, George is like, the lawyers will figure it out. And it's just like, damn, dude, that sucks. You know? Then, you know, we get the inverse with Danny. We find it's the day of the fire and stuff. Because George actually calls him up later, a little later on in Danny's story. Because he still thinks Danny Zane, like, Amy hadn't told him the truth at that time, because this was, like, pretty soon after fire, so, they were still hanging out at the hotel, he was still at the hotel with June at the time, so, he ends up, thinking that he thinks the fire was on purpose. He thinks it was arson because a guy threw it out there that it might be arson, especially, because he threw it out there as an example to be, like, if it was arson, your insurance company won't cover it. But if it's anything else, it would. That's so interesting why arson wouldn't be. Maybe you could get specific deals to cover for arson, but like, why isn't arson? Maybe there's a very specific reasons behind that. I just thought that's so interesting that arson isn't covered by your insurance. Okay, so looking into it a tiny, tiny bit, just read a little bit, it kind of is what I thought it was. It's also because it's also what the investigator was saying, too. It's like, because arson is a tool that people can use to try and fraud, like, an insurance company. Because it's like, by using that as their case, they can try and make it like, hey, I can get, but it seems like in some cases, maybe in the past you would have been able to get away with it, but they try to not pay out when it comes to an arson situation because it falls under such a criminal act. And it's also meant to stop people who might try to use arson as a means of being like, oh, I need money. I'm going to burn down this thing that I have insured. So it makes sense, but, you know, we ultimately find out Danny's case isn't arson, but we'll get to that in a second. But because of hearing all this, once again, he was just giving it as an example, but Danny and Paul immediately took it as, this is arson. To be fair, the only reason why Danny immediately took it as arson is because of what Paul said. Paul was like, oh my God, because I learned the truth about Amy, the fact of the matter is she had to have done this. I went and told her husband, confronted her husband about everything, which Danny was like, why would you do that? Like, the fact is, because in his mind, he thought, like, I hadn't made a move against Amy, and for him, it's like, oh, she retaliated. Hell, even I immediately went to, wow, Amy did this. It is so jacked up that both of us immediately went like, oh, Amy did it. It's like, no, Amy actually didn't do it, because later on, I'll go jump to it, we find out that Danny's wiring, he's the one that did he made a point of it, like, hey, I'm a construction guy, I know what I'm doing, so he did the wiring, but he screwed it up, he did a terrible job, and that's what led to the fire. So, because it was a situation of like, I know what I'm doing. I'm not going to pay someone else to do it. Plus he's too proud, because it's like, hey, I need to do it because it's my parents. I'll feel better. But once again, it doesn't fill that hole inside of himself. But he thought, like, you know, and also he could do it cheaper because he's doing it himself and not letting someone like overprice him or something like that. That's what he's probably worried about. But I think a little bit of just the personal pride of like, yeah, I can do this. I have to do this. I can do this. So, Paul's beating himself up about it, being like, yeah, this is my fault. Danny is trying to explain to his parents. It's like, no, like, it's okay. The insurance will, like, cover it. It's all going to be good. It's all going to be fine. But his parents are like, we should just go back to Korea. And just for Danny, it's just like, it sucks because it's like, I get it. You guys can, but like, you're not even concerned. Or like, oh, like, everything's like, it's going to be okay, honey. Like, it's just like, they assume the worst, and that's making Danny feel worse about himself. Cause it's like, no, like, you're making it seem like everything I did was for nothing. It's like, once again, nothing I'm doing is good enough for you, because he thinks if he can make his parents proud, once again, it'll feel something inside of him, and it won't. But it is that thing of just like, man, guys, just, why aren't you being sympathetic? Like, I'm sorry, this thing that you worked so hard for. It's okay, honey. You don't have to worry about it. They're not talking to him that way. It's just kind of like, well, we should have known something bad was going to happen. Let's just go back to Korea. It's like, you guys could, you know, they're going to stay at the apartment for a while, but they immediately left, like, sometime after. And it's just like, Danny just feels like nothing he does is good enough. Then we go back to the past and find out at a young age, obviously, him getting bullied, him not wanting to go to school anymore. But even then, it's like his mom was saying, like, maybe we'll transfer him to a different school, you know, so maybe he won't have to deal with it. But his dad's like, no, Danny's got to learn how to deal with bullies and stuff like that. And so what did Danny do? And this kind of goes back to the conversation he had with Amy last episode, argument more so. But like, Amy was like, yeah, you latch onto your brother. You're not allowing him to grow. And we see that at a point in time that it's like, oh, go take a bath, Danny. It's like, okay, come on, George. They're sleeping in the same bed. And Danny's like, okay, you got to go, like, you got to get really good grades. And that way you get raise up three grades together. That way we're in this together. Because this actually is a representation of something I think you can notice about Danny and Amy. Now, maybe it's just it's a TV show. You can't, like, write out an extensive, like, oh, friend circle. But from what we've seen, Danny and Amy don't have friends. All they have are their family. She has June and she has George. That's all Amy really has. Naomi's not really, like, you're only, like, slightly associated with Naomi because of Jordan. Other than that, like, other than your husband and your daughter, like, you don't really have any friends. All Danny has is, like, he had Isaac. That was not the best of situations necessarily. And he has George, Paul, but he latched on to Paul. That's why he even talked about it last episode with George. Like, yeah, you're a means to an end to get towards AB, but it was also like, you are the only person I could talk to about this stuff because legitimately you're the only friend that I've got. He doesn't say that part, but it's implied now in retrospect. So that's why he latched on to George so much, because he was filling a void because he had no one. He was being bullied at school. He had no friends, and he latched on to George, and that latching on to George stayed. It just got worse and worse as they got older because he stifled Paul. I think I keep saying George. I'm sorry. He stifled Paul because it was his way, because it's like, hey, as long as we're together, everything is going to be fine. Paul has always been his safety net. And later on, when the investigator called him, it's like, no, it's not arson. It was the construction company is going to be one at fault here. It's like, yeah, but he's the one that, you know, did all of it. So it falls on him. And so when the time comes, what does he do? He tells Paul, yeah, it was arson. And then Paul's beating himself up, saying, like, I should be the one that burned in that place. This is my fault. And he's like, no, this isn't your fault. He's like, why do I keep screwing up? And he's like, we didn't do anything wrong. We didn't screw up. And the fact is, he's saying that we, because obviously he's trying to make himself feel better, his own self feel better, because it's like the guilt of, man, Paul's beating himself up about it. But I'm also putting him in this position so he relies on me more, that he needs me more. Especially when we look back, Paul was like putting in like stuff about college and stuff like that. But even then, like, Danny couldn't, like, let him go, because it's like, oh, like, if you're going off to college, you should stay with me so it's easier for you to commute or whatever. But he's like, no, man, I want to do my own thing. And just in that moment, that's where, like, Danny, like, snapped even more and just destroyed any chances of Paul, like, going off on his own by, like, his sending in letters to colleges and stuff. He got rid of them just so that Paul was forced to stay there. It's like, he was kind of drowning in his own, like, once again, it came from a place of my brother became my safety net and I just never fully let him go. He's always talking about how, like, oh, like, Paul hasn't grown up. But, like, once again, back to what Amy said, you never gave him an opportunity to grow. Every time he was ready to spread his wings, you clipped him. You know, and that you know, so and that makes that even worse. I skipped over the part where when the place was on fire at the scene of the incident, he happened to see Edwin driving away, and I was like, right. I'd completely forgot about the thing where like he had gotten all those magazines last episode. I forgot to talk about it, but he was asking if Paul's the one behind it, and I was like, I don't think it's Amy, but someone's in the bushes. It didn't even cross my mind to think, and I was like, of course it was Edwin. Edwin was like fucking with him. And it kind of ended up being what I thought it was. He ended up confronting Edwin and like, he's like, did you burn the place? And he's like, no, I've been doing little stuff here and there, pranking you, messing with you, but that I would never stoop that low as to like burn down that house. Like, I'm not that psychotic. And he's like, but why would you be jealous? It's like, all Veronica does is talk about you, how great you were. And that's just, and for him, it's like, no, you won, dude. You got the girl. But for him, it's like, it's not enough. Like, the fact is she hasn't, like, she won't even let me touch her. And you're like, that's why I kind of, because anytime Veronica was around, like, you saw how, like, smiley she got around Danny, like, even early on, that I was like, feels like something might happen there, but nothing ever did. So now you're like, okay, so he's the ex that got away, but almost feeling like you're never good enough in other people's eyes. Danny gets that. He's like, yeah, it's not easy. It's not, it's hard. It's not easy. It's not an easy thing. And so when it came to all of this, he needed to double down, because the only way he was actually going to, well, he needed to prove it was arson, not only for himself to make himself feel better, but also to solidify it with Paul. Like, yeah, it was a woman's gloves found there and everything. It was definitely her. So he was going to go to the house and set it up like she did it. But at this point in time, George knows who Danny really is. I mean, and he's trying to deal with the whole June thing, but June doesn't want to be around him. She loves her mom, and she kind of hates George. Obviously, it's a confusing time. She's young. She doesn't know what's going on, and I think she's kind of taking it a little bit out on her dad because of all that. He's like, mom's kind of busy like she was with the deal, so you'll see her soon enough. I mean, to be fair, George, we already saw early on, too, that she doesn't like leaving their house. She already kind of made that clear. She probably already was agitated, like, staying at the hotel. Like, she thought that was probably, like, a little getaway, but it was a getaway without mom. She was kind of like, all right, I'll tolerate that. Now I can't see mom even more. Like, no, 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 I'm not down for that. So I think it's that. But Danny came over to plant some evidence, and George had already called 911, and Danny went in and tried to plant the glove. But I figured George came strapped, which is like he made a whole point about Amy and the gun. And it's like, now it's George with the gun. And it's like, I know who you are. I called 911. He's like, what, for saving a different name? Okay, like I pissed in like bad. Like, what have I done that's like really so criminal? It's like, you are stalkerish and you have messed up in this regard. They struggled over the gun. I was like, please don't shoot him. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. But luckily got the gun out of his hand. But he ended up like knocking George back. George ended up hitting his head on the wall, ended up passing out. I'm like, that's not going to look good for you. So the gun there, George unconscious, he decides to bail before the cops get there. But the problem is, I guess because it was dark and he was in such a rush, George ended up not paying attention, and he put either June climbed into his truck, or like the fact is that George accidentally put her in the wrong vehicle because he was in such a rush he didn't have time. Either way, and now it's like, cool, you're driving away with June. You've also got kidnapping added to it. So where this all takes us, I have no idea. There are two more episodes, so it's like two more episodes of how shit can continue to spiral out from here. I mean, Amy's going, like, Danny was, like, wasn't even Amy's fault, but Danny needed to put this on her, even though this was entirely on him. And now Amy is going to probably, like, retaliate because it's like, oh, I didn't do anything to you. Well, to be fair, it's like, you screwed me over because of, you know, what Paul did, but she didn't retaliate because of that. She was just drowning in her own sorrows because of it. And now you were trying to like frame me. That led to my husband getting hurt. You potentially almost kidnapped my daughter. So Amy might retaliate. It's going to be wild to see how this all plays out. Like I said, at the end of the day, I'm curious how will this play out for the both of them. We'll ultimately have to wait to see where the next episode takes us with all of this. But really, that's all I wanted to talk about. Until the next time we meet, be happy, be safe, live life to the fullest, and enjoy it. Good day, and goodbye.